In the last classes, we talked about, if you remember, what we talked about last classes, before self, what were the subjects? Oh, it's not there. Sorry. Which were the subjects of the last classes? Who remembers? Who can tell me? Graphs, right? After graphs. Nobody remembers? You can tell me in Portuguese. You can tell me. I'm seeing that I am in Barcelona and you are in some kind of park or something, right? Okay, so in the last class, the path I did is the following. I started talking about graphs as a model, okay? And we talked a bit about linked data, and then I started to talk about RDF, you remember? And syntax and semantics. So I show it, I explain it. Why we tell that the RDF has explicit semantics. Okay? Today I will focus a bit more in what we call knowledge representation. And why? Because in some sense the semantic web, the RDF, the OWL, they are a kind of option or a kind of formalism to represent knowledge. And we must understand why they decided to do in this way. Okay, so what we can do when we represent ontologies. So, I don't know if you know this game we call Animals. It's an old game, okay? And this game is a game in which the system wants to discover which animal are you are thinking, okay? So it starts the system telling, okay, think in some animal, okay? And then the system starts to ask you questions, okay? So if you enter here and put animal game, dot com. Okay, so you can play here and it asks you, for example, you must think some animal, okay? Think an animal, okay? And the system will discover which animal you are thinking, okay? So it asks you, can it fly? And you tell, yes or no. For example, let's think something like prehistoric animal. No, it's too much, right? Let's think something like a zebra, okay? It fly? No. And then it asks you, it's very small animal? No. Can you ride this animal? I think so, right? I don't know. Zebra is... I don't know. It's hard. I don't know. Let's put yes. Probably. It have a trunk. Trunk? Trunk is trunk. I don't know what's trunk. Huh? Ah, oh, yes, has a trunk. Let's see what happens. It's distinct? No. Does it have legs? Yes. Does it speak a language? No. Does it have horns coming from its mouth? Oh my God. No. Ah, yeah, yeah. Oh my God. Does this animal give you milk with a trauma? Oh my God. Okay, so at the end, you can, let's tell yes. Let's see what happens here. Does father is a donkey? Let's say yes. I don't know. Does mother is a donkey? Yes. Oh my God. How many questions is it? It's a donkey. So it goes until it tells you what is this. Okay? And if it's right, okay, if you grab some repetition, then it reinforces the knowledge, in the sense it reinforces this is a good test. And if it's wrong, if you ask you which animal are you thinking, for example, if you tell no here, but it must be logadin, and in teach me it will ask you which animal are you thinking and what is the difference of this animal, donkey for example, and the animal that you are thinking. Okay. And what this simple game teach us? It's based in an old knowledge representation we call decision tree. And what is a decision tree? The idea of decision tree is that you have decisions which gives you true and false. Okay. Usually are two paths. Okay. And at the nodes. Okay. We have the answer or the final decision. And it's highly used to something we call a specialist system. So, for example, the oldest I have record is the Meissen. The Meissen is a system they developed to assist people that will do diagnosis in the field. So they have this idea that someone can bring a notebook to the field and can do a diagnosis of some people with disease. So the system asks, for example, what is the sex that now we call gender, the age, and some data about blood and so on and so forth. So you may imagine that you can have a people with some kind of basic information, how to collect the blood, how to do basic analysis, and we to insert in the system. So if you imagine that this guy brings a notebook to some place that is far from the big cities, and it can help someone with some disease or some problem before a doctor or someone, okay? And so the system asks the guy about the conditions of the blood, if there is some characteristics, and it's a specialist system. How it works? It will follow a kind of decision tree. Okay, it's more complex than the animal game, but it's a decision tree in which you start following a path and yes, no, or you can have, for example, three options, and depending on the option, you go in one path. And at the end, the system will tell you, okay, based in the data you gave me, okay, it will give you some possible diagnosis and treatment. Okay, and the interesting thing about this system is that you can ask it the rationale, the idea behind the knowledge. how you concluded that, okay? How you concluded that it has this disease. And the system will go in the tree and follow the path again and tell you, I did that because that, because that, because that, because that. Do you remember that when I told you about semantic web, there is a level we call proof, right? And to define the proof, you must know what is the, you must have traceability. You must have which is the path you follow to conclude something. Okay? And this approach, you can do that. And one interesting thing in this kind of system, if you see the architecture, is one of the first things or systems that started talking about knowledge base. Okay? And what is a knowledge base here? The knowledge base is this decision tree that's designed by a specialist. So you see here that you have two guys, which is the domain expert, okay, and a knowledge engineering, which is the guy that is trained to extract the knowledge from the domain expert and transform it in a representation of a decision tree. Okay. You also have the knowledge base, which is this data. And an interesting thing here is you can represent the knowledge independent of the software. Okay. So now you have something that is generic. We call inference engine. What is an inference engine? It's a generic software that can read the knowledge and can infer something. So it goes towards the tree, follows the tree, and do some inference. Okay? So, this is one of the first approaches. And you can have, you see, this is a modern work to tell that until now people use decision trees. For example, it's highly used in medicine, not necessarily in automatized. They have text documents to train doctors defining what they call protocol, in which you follow some decision trees to define if someone has this or that. Okay. To represent knowledge, we use formally. Okay. And one thing that for me is very important is when people tell about ontologies, usually people start telling an ontology is a graph. Or an ontology is a tree. And I insist that a tree or a graph is an approach, a possible approach to model an ontology. Okay? But there are other approaches. So an ontology is not necessarily a graph. It can be modeled by a graph. Okay? So, some historical perspective of knowledge representation. It's important to tell you why I'm talking about formalisms. If we are studying web, okay? This is a citation of in this book, which tells that the it's typical of the scientific optimism to forget its own history, because if you when you forget your history, you are condemned in English, right? To repeat the history, committing the same mistakes again. Okay? And why am I telling that? Because when you go to the ontology area, and we have a lot of people from the web working on this area, we are not there are a lot of people that developed a lot of work before us in the area of knowledge representation, inferences, and so on and so forth. And for example, I did several works exploiting some works on the past. Okay, so I get, for example, I have some works that I got some interesting algorithms from 96, for example, and got these works and showed that we can reinterpret them, or we can update these ideas to what we do with ontologies, because people did that in the past with other formalisms, but they are still good. Okay. For example, when we do these networks algorithms, people from reps tell us that they did that a lot, and we are just repeating the things they did. So we must be careful to understand the history of the things, to know that the things we do now, there are long histories, okay? So, to understand how we represent now ontologies, we must understand the history. We must understand how people did that. Okay? So, these are some formalisms adopted to represent knowledge. And I got this organization from this text, which is a good text, talking about knowledge representation, and he tells that we have basically two main groups of approaches. The first one is the predicates, and the second one is classes and relations. Okay, and I will show you that in the semantic web we have both. Okay. So let's talk about formalisms. We have something we call production rules. And what are production rules? Production rules is the following. This is from Babylon. So if you want an old citation, okay, before Christ, I think it's old, right? Try to write that in a paper to see what people will tell you. Okay. But here is a citation of how Babylonics, okay, how they have some rules to administration of the people, okay? So this rule tells, if a horse enters a man's house and bites either an ass or a man, the owner of the house will die, and his household will be scattered. Okay? So, if man willingly treads on a lizard and kills it, he will prevail of his adversary. So, what this rule tells us? This is a kind of production rule, which is something that has two parts. First part is you define the conditions. If a horse enters a man's house and bites, so you define the conditions. And you have the second part that is the consequence. What will happen if the first part occurs? And why we call it production rule? Because you produce a new knowledge based on a previous knowledge. Okay? This is a good, interesting medical rule from Babylon. If the after a day's illness, he begins to suffer from headache. If the onset of his illness, he had a prick heat, and if he is hot in one place and cold in another, if the affected area is clammy and sweet, he will die suddenly. Oh, imagine. Imagine you are reading this text. So, this is a production rule, okay? You define a set of conditions. Usually, if you remember when you studied formal languages, formal language has production rules, okay? But we are talking about not knowledge production rules, but R production rules. You have some patterns in the left, and when you fit in the pattern of the left, you produce something in the right, okay? Everybody understood that? So, for example, mycin that I show you, they designed the system based on production rule. Yeah. Okay? So you have the premise of things, and these premises produces some new knowledge. So I told you that is a decision tree, but in fact is based on production rule. So, for example, you have a set of rules that telling that. For example, if you have something which is whose morphology is round and it's an aerobic thing and so on and so forth, you conclude that it's a bacterioid study, for example. So there are production rules, okay? And you have a set of and when you have production rules, and when you do conclusions with production rules, you can go back and know which is the path you followed producing things to conclude what you produce. Another approach is what we call programming in logic. And Datalog is a language derived from Prolog, which is an example of this thing. So imagine the following. Imagine I have some case in which I have taxis on the Unicamp. This is a kind of hypothetical scenario, right? Because we don't have taxis here, but okay. And since we have a lot of taxis at Unicamp, we want to define things in zones. So for example, we have the map of the Unicamp and we divide it in 4 zones. But since they are too big, we organize these zones in smaller zones. Okay? Smaller. So you have 2 bigger zones, and inside the bigger zones, you have smaller zones. So now, you may imagine that, for example, Unicamp, we have the Unicamp, which is inside a city. You have 4 main zones, which is inside Unicamp. And then you have several smaller zones, which are inside the bigger zones. We can represent it in a table. Now, I will show you a different approach to represent it, based in what we call Prolog, which is programming logic. So in Prolog, we'll have something we call literal, which is something that you are telling something. Okay? And I will show you that this kind of way of representing things is now influencing the semantic web. Okay? So we have a language in the semantic web we call SWRL, semantic web rule language, okay, which is based on this kind of approach. Okay. So, for example, here is something we call literal. A literal has, for example, some kind of thing we call predicate, a driver, for example. Okay, and we have a set of attributes here, okay, which are constants, okay. So this driver has this kind of car, which has this plate, and the driver, the name of the driver is Kinkas. So this is some kind of literal. And all prologue rule, no. Then we have what we call rules, okay. And what is a rule? You can tell that if you have something, some person that drives a car, you can conclude that the driver of this car is this person. Okay? It's similar to the production rules. It's similar, okay, to the idea of production rules. But the difference here is much more in the direction you do your conclusions. In fact, what happens here is let me show you here. Let me show you more. I show further that the difference here, I showed you in the opposite direction. In fact, a rule is something that you have the head and the body, right? And is the opposite of the production rule, in the sense that if some person is the driver of some car, okay, then you can conclude, okay, you conclude the left based on the right, okay? So you can conclude that this person drives the car. Okay, so this is when you have just the predicate, as I showed you, it is something we call effect. And here is a quick example showing you that I can produce facts telling that Unicamp is in the zone, so I can produce a fact zone, Unicamp City, Unicamp North, Unicamp. So this zone means that the left guy is inside the zone of the right guy. And I write that as facts. Okay, I write this thing as a fact. In some sense, when I show you the connection of SWRL and RDF, I show you that this formalism can be transformed in a graph, in some sense. Okay. And this produces this tree that is, sorry, this tree is, but this is the hierarchy that I showed you, okay, of something inside another thing. And we can produce rules that are transitive. So for example, if a zone is inside a super zone, okay? Oh, no. How can I tell that some zone is part of a super zone? If this zone is under the super zone, okay, or if this zone is under an intermediary zone here, so this is recursive, and this intermediary zone is part of the super zone. So this is something that you can expand and do inference on it. Okay, so here there are details that I jump, just showing how you can do inferences, how the system will use that to do inferences. But the importance here is just show you that there are this way to represent knowledge. You can represent knowledge like that. You can even build, if you wish, an ontology using that without necessarily telling this is a graph. Okay? When I talked to you about the semantics, you remember that I started talking how we see the world. Remember that? So we see the world like classes and attributes and so on and so forth. And for this reason, we have a group of ways of representing knowledge which is based on classes and relations. For example, the frames is an approach. I don't know if you know Marvin Minsky, but Marvin Minsky is a highly important person in artificial intelligence. Okay? So, what Marvin Minsky tried to do is define this frames approach, trying to explain how our minds think about the world. Okay? So, it's tried to do some kind of framework for the thinking. And, okay, so it wants to produce a kind of unified theory. And the essence of the frame theory is the following. When you find a new situation, you find something new. Okay? So, for example, you see a new person or you enter in a new room. Okay? Okay. You go to your memory, try to find something they call a frame. Okay? And this frame is a kind of framework which will be adapted and filled with details to fit in the new reality. So, it's something we called last classes a stereotype. You remember a stereotype? I told you that we classify things, right? We put things in classes. And for this reason, we also do that in ontologies. Okay? And this frame theory is trying to bring the same idea. The frame, you can think of frame as a generalization. Like what we do, you see, a frame is a data structure representing a stereotyped situation. So it's the same idea. Okay. It's a network of nodes and relations, terminal slots. So, these frames influenced the way of how we define, for example, the RDF. Okay? So you remember that I showed you that RDF has this class model, right? And this class model of RDF was highly influenced by this frame approach, which is the basic idea that you have a kind of template. And you have a kind of slots. So let's think what is the template. Okay? You see a new person you never saw before. First time you see. And then you think your memory, you store all details of this person. But it's not true. I told you. It's not true. Okay? What your mind will do, it will capture a frame of a person. So you have a template of a person and you look on the differentials. The colors of the eyes, the hair, the kind of hair, the kind of way people organized her and so on and so forth. So you get your template, what's the person, and you fill your template with this slot, what we call slot, giving values of this new situation. Okay? And this frame tells you how this new thing will behave. You know how this new thing will behave, right? How a person will behave. A person will talk with you. For example, if you see a person and this person starts to fly, what do you think? First, I'm dreaming, right? Second, I'm crazy. Okay, it's possible. Okay. Third, the person is flying, the superhero or something. But it's just to tell you that the person will behave in the things you know is a person. You will never see a person flying. Sorry about that. You will never see a person flying. Okay, in some special occasions, probably, if someone is launched by a catapult, probably you see a person flying, but this is not the case. But the important thing in the frame theory is that it's highly connected to this idea of classes, generalization, and another important thing in the frames is that the way it is connected, its representation of things is highly connected to the idea of connection, the notion of classes and so on, and also networks of knowledge. Which in some sense, if you think the formalism of OWL, RDF and so on, they are networks of knowledge at the same time they have this idea of classes of things. Okay. Okay. So sorry I jumped that because the object orientation has some influences, but I'll jump this part. Other formalisms are semantic networks. And what's a semantic network? The idea is, then I will see the connection with graphs. Okay? People start to define that knowledge. So this is the first semantic network in Spain. Okay, so we are talking about old citations here. This is an old citation, okay. But the basic idea of a semantic network is you represent your knowledge as nodes, and you have edges with some kind of meaning connecting these nodes, okay? And the semantic networks highly influence also the way you represent the semantic web as a graph with nodes and oriented edges with some meaning. So you can produce a kind of ontology doing that in the semantic web. The last formalism here is what we call description logics. Description logics, the thing is, the logic in general, when you talk about logics, there are several formalisms to work with logics. First order logic, which is considered highly powerful to represent things, and other kinds of logics. The problem is, depending on the kind of logics, can be hard to define things that are computable. Okay? So what I call computable, I want to infer something And sometimes you cannot compute it. It's not computable. Because some kind of logics will not guarantee that the construction you did will not have contradictions, will bring you something. And the idea of producing these description logics is the idea of producing some logics which can give you guarantees that this will be computable. Okay? That you can do some kinds of conclusions in the things you do. Okay? And I show you that the semantic web formalists, they have influences of description logics also. So, in some sense, I show in the next class that the formalism in semantic webs, RVF and OWF, in some sense, is a compilation of several previous formalisms in such a way that you can represent knowledge on the web in a distributed form, connecting things in a graph. One important thing here is to understand that there are a lot of work in these areas that can be used now. For example, I developed an interesting research getting papers of people doing interesting things in semantic networks. For example, comparing similarity among things, analyzing the semantic network. And then I just got this idea, and since the formalisms of the semantic web have high influence of semantic networks, I can represent in some sense the knowledge as a semantic networks. I could get these algorithms and adapt them to the semantic web. Okay? Got it?